Ladies and gentlemen, Leo Varinsky. Please, yes. Thank you. Yeah. To dress up funny. Tonight, he's dressed up like Frank Zappa. Let's ask him, what's the deal? A real nice place to raise your kids up.
Just like Glendale. It's a rancid boutique.
San Francisco,
where everybody thinks they're heavy business. It's just a tuna sandwich from another catering service.
Thank you. place and get to a town with a lot of hot action.
My cowboy dance, 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 my c
by you a taste. You can sit on my face. Where's my waitress? Oh boy, you hot little bitch. Hey, who are these dudes? Are you a boy or a girl? Somebody can sit on your face.
A very unpleasant occupation, no?
Like a piggyback ride in an unusual position.
You mean I will buy you an alcoholic drink and you can have a piggyback ride? Sitting on my face?
What the fuck was that? I wonder that son of a bitch can play something I might like. Hey, twerp! Play me a tune I can enjoy.
It is time now to to have an interview.
I don't know very much about you. I'm new at this, you see. Just came to do an interview. I'm just getting my little notebook and have trouble working my tape recorder because I'm not very mechanical. I can never get it to work when I want it.
Which is why
I got my notebook with me here. Why don't you tell me how you feel?
I do you call?
your group name is real weird, cause you look weird yourself. So many groups got such weird names today, it is so hard to catch up on it.
You don't mind if we get some pictures, do you?
We got all kinds of cameras and bombs and white ambulances to make you look just like the prayer troll or something of that nature. Make you look real weird and far fucking out. I'll just stick this lens on here and fix it. So, oh my god, you look like a creep. The kids who read a rock and roll newspaper like to see famous musicians who look far out and gloomy. Groovy vibes over there because it is so European. I can just imagine you and your little group going all over Europe, at Paris, Rome, Strasbourg, even the Viennese. I just want to verify a rumor I heard. Is it true that in the autumn of 1968, you and a bunch of old crisp buffoons actually held a secret rehearsal with members of the BBC Symphony in the back room of an exotic English pub out on Seven Sister Roads? And there, unbeknownst to the outside world at large, did proceed to illicitly manufacture a semi-pornographic situation comedy rock and roll station based on all the reasons why everybody wants to quit your group, whatever you call it. Isn't it also true that you put this show together against all known laws of men and nature, including costumes, in 3 days? Except for the music you wrote in some moderately extravagant Viennese hotel. The same hotel where you made some questionable 16mm movies of your wife and unidentified foot.
Seconds of fame. Say hi to Dad.
has also been rumored that you persisted in mounting your silly little production, even against the best judgment of Herbie Cohen, having the audacity to perform it twice in one night at the very Royal Hall Festival itself, or upon its sweep receive a Chris Welch Melody Make review pronouncing it totally rancid and devoid of relevant social comment and or minimum entertainment value? Just look at this. Tony. A silly dummy like this could never be very heavy.
Home. You were
performing an unnatural act with that dummy.
No, I wasn't.
You were getting hot with it. I saw you rubbing.
What did you... Why should a person like myself be like that?
You were beaten off or something. You were working up to beating off. You were rubbing your tits with the deformed hand of a dummy.
No.
Shame on you. Shame on every one of you. You rock and roll journalists are all the same. Masturbate, masturbate, masturbate.
Yes, oh, you caught me doing it. Mostly, I just do it with a typewriter.
Did you get any gratification?
Lots of great pictures.
One night, I couldn't get any action after the concert. I went back to the hotel by myself. I made some instant coffee and I took out the music I'd been working on. Small ensemble. It was called I've Seen the Pleated Gazelle.
Gazelle. People might wonder why a person might want to write something like this. It's not pretty and it doesn't make any sense at all. But that didn't matter to me while I was writing it. I just wrote down whatever came to mind. I figured I'd never get to hear it anyway. It occurred to me later that night that if, by some chance,
the Pleated Gazelle was ever performed, the audience might like it better if it had a story. A story. Once upon a time, there was a girl. She always wore a green wool overcoat. Fish and Vienna sausages pinned on it, on the shoulders. One day, she flipped out. Had a terrible fight with her boyfriend one night. She told him to go away, and she beat him with a plastic fish. She ate some Vienna sausages to calm down. Then she met a newt rancher, a young lad who raised newts so that rich people could have coats made out of them. She loved him a lot, and they started shacking up on the ranch where he grew the newts. Everything was fine. Except that he was in love with an industrial vacuum cleaner. Girl was afraid of the dark and the night, and sometimes the newts. But more than anything, she was getting worried about the young lad's attachment to the industrial vacuum cleaner. Whenever he had to go out at night to see if the newts had dashed off, she'd stay home and knit big socks, sobbing to herself. Then he came home, all tired out. She put down the big sock she'd been working on and looked up at him longingly. She wanted him to love her as much as he loved his industrial vacuum cleaner and the newts in the yard. She dreamed of ways of winning his love.
Fix him some broth.
Would you like some broth?
Some nice soup.
Some hot broth.
Small tartlet.
Do
you like broth? Dark broth?
Hot broth?
You like version the pool. In a statement to the press, explains. Cardboard boxes with a noun suit painted all over them. Four views, every side of the boxes, another thrilling view of a black and starching and suit, inspiring in its simplicity. Quality goods. Simplicity, nearly able to get off behind it.
Tinsel cards.
Our tinsel scarlet are hot and dewy.
Would you like some broth?
Some nice soup?
Some hot broth?
If there was a story, especially a love story, more people in the audience could identify with or vicariously participate in the concepts involving newts, dogs, gazelles, and hot nun debris.
Why don't you strap this here bunch of cardboard boxes, Daddy? Child of my design, you certainly look suave, and get me hot, 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 get me hot and horny.
Why? There are many reasons why I drag a girl such as yourself back to this plastic hotel room to rip you off for some spare change, to run a vibrating machine attached to this queen-size, bulk-board, K-pop-infested, do-not-remove-label under penalty of law-type bed, and make you remove all your little clothes until you are stark raving nude, save for your chrome with heavy leather duty peace medallion, and make you assume an array of marginally erotic poses involving a plastic chair and an old guitar strap, while I did a wee-wee in your hair and beat you with a pair of tennis shoes I got from Jeff Beck.
Great. It's just as if Donovan himself had appeared on my very own TV screen with words of peace, love, and eternal cosmic wisdom. Rantum, toom, toom, tan, toom, toom! Oh, leading me, guiding me on paths of everlasting pseudo-karmic negligence in the very midst of my very own drug-induced nocturnal emission.
For I am your good conscience, Jeff. I know all. I see all. I am a cosmic love pulse matrix becoming a technicolor interpositive.
Eh? Where'd you buy that incense? It's hip.
It's the same mysterious and exotic oriental fragrance as what the Beatles get off on.
I thought I recognized it.
What's that? Musk?
Jeff, I know what's best for you.
Right. You're heavy.
Yes, Jeff. I'm your guiding light. Listen to me. Don't rip out the towel, Jeff.
Piss off, you big nitwit.
Hey, man. What's the deal?
Don't listen to him, Jeff. He's no good. He'll make you do bad things.
You mean he'll make me sin?
Have a word with you about yourself.
No, don't listen, Jeff.
Why are you wasting your life night after night playing this comedy music?
You're right. I'm too heavy to be in this group.
Comedy music.
In this group, all I ever get to do is play Zappa's comedy music. He eats.
Jeff.
I get so tense.
Of course you do, my boy.
The things he makes me do are always off the wall.
That's why it would be best to leave his stern employ.
And quit the group.
We'll make it big.
That's right.
Of course.
And then I won't be small. Mat 6 weeks ago at a rancid motel in Orlando, Florida, with the highest mildew rating of any commercial lodging facility within the territorial limits of the United States, naturally excluding tropical possessions. Oh, it's still damp. What an aroma. Oh, this is the best I ever got off. What can I say about this elixir? Try it on steaks. Oh, it cleans nylons. Small craft warnings. It's great for the home. Office on fruits.
This is the real you, Jeff. Rip off a few more ashtrays. Get rid of that inattention. Quit the comedy group. Get a group of your own together, heavy, like Grand Funk Railroad. More black hammer.
No, Jeff.
More COVID. What can I say about this elixir?
Jay's gonna have all that stuff.
He should never have used the elixir and only stuck to the incense. Oh, Atlantis!
That was Billy the Mountain dressed up like Donovan fading out on the wall-mounted TV screen. Jeff is flipping out. Road fatigue. We gotta get him back to normal before Zappa finds out and steals it and makes him do it in the movie.
Delicate personal membranes? No shit, Howie. We just like musicians for friends, huh?
Oh, man, what's he doing?
You have a brilliant career ahead of you, my boy. Just get out of this group.
Latex, Fauntleroy, masseuse!
Howard, that was Tuna Baker Hoff dressed up like Jim Pond giving career guidance to the bass player of a rock-oriented comedy group. Jeff's imagination has gone beyond the fringe of audience comprehension.
Jeff! Jeff, it's me, the Clarissa Lee!
What can I say about this elixir?
Jeff, Jeff, it's me, Eddie! What can a person like me say about this elixir?
Use it to clean the drain. Or you can always tell Tim Miller and tell her it's a really tie-dye gift. Or then you get your mic just like, your windows never look so good. And you can put pizza, read it, put your shoes, tie your wife down with it.
What?
What can I? What? What can I say about this? After night, dinners with Herb Cohen, thrill-packed, fun-filled evenings on the French Riviera at the Midend Convention. A beige tie, the whole bit. Watch Mutt eat and Leon feed the geese. 1,000 green business cards with your name and the wrong address, plus royalty statements. All inspected and dedicated by Han to Ram, Fran to Helen and Dee. Followed by 12 potential suicides, as the members of your group, past and present, find out they cannot collect unemployment. A dog. A car. An epidemic of body lice. Oh, your own record company, your name on the door, and an electric buzzer to the inner room, plus Ona's tits. A 3-month supply of German bookings with tickets on air and boom. Does this kind of life look interesting to you? As a fake rock and roll guitar player in a comedy group?
Thank you. Oh,
that your penis, and in the case of many dignified ladies, that the size of the titties themselves might provide elements of subconscious tension.
Weird, twisted anxieties that could force a human being to become a politician, a policeman, a Jesuit monk,
a rock and roll guitar player,
a whiner,
you name it. And in the case of the ladies,
the ones that can't afford a silicon beef up,
they become the writers of hot books.
Manuel the gardener placed his burning phallus in her quivering quin.
Yes! Or they become Carmelite nuns!
Gonzo, the lead guitarist, placed his mutated member in her slithering seat.
Or racehorse jockeys. There is no reason that you or your loved ones should have to suffer.
Things are bad enough without the size of your organ added any more trouble to the miseries of the world.
Now, if you're a lady and you've got munchkin tits, you can console yourself with the age-old line from primary school. Anything over a mouthful is wasted.
Ain't that the truth?
And if you're a guy and one night you're at a party and you're trying to be cool.
Me, you know where the underpants have been so cool.
And someone comes up to you one night and hits on you and looks you up and down and he says,
8 inches or less.
Well, let me tell you, brother, that's the time you gotta turn around and look that son of a bitch right between the eyes and you gotta tell him these words.
In some instances, it should be classified as a lethal weapon.
Penis! Ew. Penis!
are revolting. The way you guys say it. Oh, caca.
Caca!
A penis can be a very interesting and exciting organ.
Very exciting once you get to that way.
Penis!
It sounds so overwhelmingly medicinal.
A penis sounds like something a doctor would have hanging off him.
None of the men I love and know in rock and roll business got a penis. They all got cocks, or dicks at least.
Sure, got to slap on a pop star and he wants to stuff a penis up you. What is that art?
Let's ask our studio audience! Will you trade what he has in his pants for what I have on this screen?
What is that?
You mean in his pants?
I know what's in his pants. He's a lonely guy.
You have to choose before the big wheel stops swirling. Oh, you. Go whirl the big wheel.
I want the money.
There isn't any money. Just the screen and...
The lonely guy?
The screen!
Time is running out. Think it over carefully.
The screen?
I want the money.
Wait!
What could it be? In his pants? On the screen!
Don't anyone care what's in my pants?
It's too little to be a car or a refrigerator.
Don't be deceived by the size of the screen.
Yeah.
Thank you.